Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
To order, and I will ask Mr. Sutton if he'll have our invocation, please.
We can take a moment, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for another season. Please be with us, with our residents, county residents, with our state residents, in our country, and across the world, with the needs that this new season will bring upon them. Please be with the officials in the Gulf of Mexico as they attempt to stop the oil leak. And please be with our military around the world as they fight for what we believe in as a nation. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. At this time, I will have the public comments. Beverly Kerr, if you'll come up and... And just a reminder, this is 3 minutes per person, okay?
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm. Good evening.
How you doing?
I'm trying to understand the burning regulations in Alamance County. I have a lot of concerns about clean air and polluting industries. And right now on my mind is Stericycle, which is a medical waste incinerator. And so in order to talk to you tonight, I went to your Alamance County website to read about the burning and what the regulations are. And the first thing that came up was this information, and it says, this is from the Alamance County website, did you know that burning trash is illegal and you could be fined up to $10,000 per day for burning trash? Backyard burning. This is talking about private citizens burning a cardboard box or maybe leaves in their own backyard. $10,000 a day. Is that right?
I think you can burn leaves.
You can burn leaves?
Yes, ma'am, you can.
But not boxes.
And brush. Mm-hmm.
And so a private citizen could be charged up to $10,000 a day. And the reason for that, it says, is that a family of four burning their household trash in a burn barrel could release emissions of dioxins and furans toxics equivalent to a well-controlled municipal waste incinerator burning 200 tons of garbage per day. And that's a well-controlled municipal waste incinerator. So it sounds like Alamance County is taking it real seriously about clean air and burning, that incineration is a hazard. And then I saw this. Cancer among Alamance County residents is 226 times the acceptable EPA rate according to the Healthy Alamance report. And that report was funded by Alamance County and approved by Alamance County. 226 times the acceptable EPA rate. That sounds so serious to me, I'm surprised that we haven't seen it on the front page of the news. Okay, so my question is, if we're taking it seriously and a private citizen can be so charged, will you be very careful with medical waste incinerators in Alamance County and make sure that they are properly regulated and doing everything that should be done not to pollute the air, especially for the children? I have a child care center, and so we looked at a map, and we see that there are about 22 schools and 13 daycares within close proximity to Stericycle. And we're worried about it, and we hope you are too, and we hope you'll do anything that is within your power to make sure that that they don't pollute unnecessarily. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, next is Heather
Jor.
I got that right,
didn't I?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Scandinavian J's
look
a
Y. Uh-huh. I'm here tonight on the same issue that I was here to see you last month, and that's related to the medical waste incineration. I'm here as a parent, I'm here as a business owner, and I'm here as a children's advocate. Stericycle is the largest medical waste incinerator in the nation. North Carolina has the title of Medical Waste Incinerator Capital of the United States, It's home to 3 of 14 commercial medical waste incinerators. Hog River, of course, has 2 because there's 2 separate units. They are burning 26.3 million pounds of medical waste from 22 states. They burn the equivalent of 0.5 pound of medical waste every single day for every single person in Alamance County. The incinerator operates 24/7. The type of things that they're releasing into the air are dioxins, cadmium, lead. Dioxins are considered to be the most harmful substance on the face of the planet. Carbon monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, lead, cadmium, mercury, all things which cause serious problems, everything from motor delays, birth defects, cancers, and linked to several other serious illnesses and diseases. My concern is that for people that are knowledgeable about this, for any type of physical activity that you or I would participate in, children are actually taking in a significantly higher amount of air pollution because, first of all, they breathe more rapidly. Secondly, they're exerting usually at 20 to 30% more. And they also additionally tend to be outside more, so they're taking in more air pollution as well. And if you think about a child's body compared to ours, whereas most of us might average somewhere between 115 to 150 pounds, you have a child that could be anywhere from 3 pounds, or, well, 5 pounds at birth, 6 pounds, up to my daughter who's 6, maybe about 60 pounds. And when you think about the concentration of the amount of pollution in that child's body, and they're taking in more, that is a serious concern to me as a parent. I have lived here for 16 years. I cannot fathom why we are allowing them to be burning, and what they're burning. They're burning international garbage, they're burning plastics, they're burning chemo waste that has not been proven that there's not anything harmful with burning it. I cannot fathom why, as the council, you would not do everything possible to protect your citizens, to protect the children that are in your county, as well as children that have yet to be born, and pregnant women are a particular risk for this pollution. I urge you to clearly review the data that we've shared, and I would ask you to vote for the resolution that would require them to come under the new EPA limits. We're talking about significant reductions, dioxins, a reduction of 93%, hydrogen chloride, a reduction of 93%, lead, a reduction of 97%, and to ask them to come into compliance by 2012 instead of 2014. And stop poisoning our air. Thank you.
And I did want to clarify one thing. It's in the Graham city limits, not Hall River, because I want to clear that up, because the Hall River Town Council's here tonight, so we don't want to. So I wanted to clear that up before we
clear the air, right?
I had to clear that up, yeah. It's in Graham. Okay, next is Dave DeJort.
Mm-hmm. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for giving me a couple minutes to speak. My role here tonight is not only to reinforce some of the thoughts that you just heard from the speakers before me, but just to state my position. I'm a father of 2, been a resident of Alamance County since 1996. And like probably most of the people in this room, I have to say that the safety and well-being of my family and my community is paramount to me. When we first moved into our neighborhood, just a quick side story is the speed limit on our street, we're off of a busy feeder street that goes into our plan, was much too fast for the area. Consequently, when we took walks at night, there were cars speeding 20, 30 miles an hour over the speed limit sometimes, and in an effort to make a proactive attempt to make our neighborhood safer, we worked with the city of Burlington and the neighborhood around us, and we were able to reduce the speed limits and get a four-way stop sign in our community. As a parent, obviously, even though I don't know that there were any accidents or fatalities or even injuries to speak of, we all sleep a whole lot better. In a similar vein, air that we breathe, the water that we drink is basic essentials. And we have a facility nearby that the more that I learn about the type of pollutants that they're putting into the air, though I can't necessarily put my finger on anything. I can't prove anything. I think there are a lot of other people that's a lot smarter than I am that have the records of the levels of pollutants and the cancers and the things that are potential and are being caused. You have it in your power to make some decisions this evening that can make things a whole lot safer, a whole lot better for our community and for our folks. And I ask you with my whole heart to make the right decision, especially in the light of the fact that also, as I've learned, there are a lot of other cities, a lot of other counties around the state that have already passed and approved resolutions to bring tougher standards into play a lot quicker than they have to be right now. And it's the EPA standards by 2012, I believe. And so, again, even if you aren't sure, just be safer than sorry. Why have people look at you as the ones that decided not to act? I think you have an opportunity, and I ask you to do so. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, at this time, I'm closing public comments. And we will go to open. I will now open the public hearing on economic development incentives. Mr. Williams is going to give us some information here.
Good evening, Madam Chairman and Commissioners. My name is Mac Williams with the Chamber of Commerce here in Alamance County. As has been published, the LabCorp has a project for which economic incentives are being sought. As has been published, the project is a laboratory facility. The capital investment of a little over $27 million. The facility size 110,000 square feet here in Burlington. And so what I'm want to do is to provide you all with some opportunities and the public with an opportunity for a question and comment. And we have tonight with us three officials with the company. Mark Schroeder is a Senior Vice President of Supply Chain Management. Gary Ahern is Manager of Corporate Facilities. And Tarek Azari is the Divisional Counsel. And I'll introduce, I guess, Mark to come up and introduce himself and provide any further detail, and then between the three of them, hopefully any questions that you have can be answered.
Okay. Good evening,
Mr. Schroeder. Good evening. Thanks for the introduction, Mac. Mac has described the project as accurate. We're looking to build a $27.6 million expansion onto our laboratory facility that currently is at York Court. Two stories, 55,000 square feet, and I am open to any questions that the commissioners may have.
Anybody got any questions for Mr. Schroeder?
I'm just glad that you are planning to build in Burlington and in Alamance County. We're glad you're here.
We're glad we're here too, and we're building for the future.
Does that future mean that you're staying here? I have to ask.
Well,
there was a little leak there about a year ago.
Between the new corporate building we built in downtown Burlington and this rather large expansion at one of our largest laboratories in the country, I think it's safe to say that we're here for the long haul.
I have read the agreement, and it seems like it's pretty airtight, too. So, because if you don't meet your benchmarks, you just
That's correct.
I notice in here you don't have any employees listed, but who's going to man this facility?
Well, our current facility is overcrowded. Over the past 18 or so months, we have been looking at where we do our testing across the country, and we want to build capacity here. So we need to expand the lab, we need to reconfigure inside, and certainly be available to take on incremental growth over time.
It's exciting that you do want to stay here.
All right. Good.
Yeah.
Mr. Sutton, any questions?
I think everybody knows how I feel about cash incentives.
No point for me. Okay. I don't have any questions.
Okay.
Thank you
so much. Anybody in the audience would like to speak? Come on up, Mr. Gomery.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be in front of you again. My only hope would be that I would get to do this monthly as we would talk about opportunities here in Alamance County. I'm here just to speak on behalf of acceptance of the proposal to grant these incentives slash investments for the LabCorp expansion. You know, it's my job as a banker, you know, one of the things I look at is I look at the numbers. What they're asking for is a 2% incentive with a tax rate of about 0.5%. As best my math serves me, that's about a 4-year payback. Certainly these facilities have a much more longer economic useful life than that, and we will be the benefactor of significant tax base increase over the remaining life of that property. As you all have known, as you've gone through the most recent budget, you know, there's really only two ways to make meaningful increases in the revenue side of the balance sheet or the income statement for the county. One is to either increase the tax base or increase the tax rate. What we have here is an opportunity to increase the tax base. While they did speak of the fact that there are no concrete jobs being added with this facility, certainly a $27.6 million investment in a facility is going to result in somebody working inside of that building. Not to say anything negative to LabCorp, but as a company that is sensitive to return to their shareholders, they need to make decisions based on what is in the economic well-being of those shareholders. And recently they made a decision that did not include an expansion in Burlington for just such a reason. So I don't think that we can just assume, because of our relationship with LabCorp, that this building will automatically be located in Burlington. And if it should be located somewhere else, these jobs, while not new jobs, would most likely transition to that new location. So what we are faced with is the possibility of perhaps not adding new jobs to Alamance County, but perhaps transitioning them to another county. The other thing that I look at when I look at a request like this is, what is this corporate entity that's asking about it? Certainly there's no finer corporate citizen, no company any more important to Alamance County than LabCorp. They're involved in just about every board that I'm involved with. They give a lot back to the community. And certainly, as a publicly traded entity, their financial situation is certainly strong enough to assure that we will continue to get the income stream that we're bargaining for with this. So with those three addenda items, increasing the tax base, holding on to jobs that we have, and being able to provide an incentive to a good corporate citizen with the capability to be here long enough to pay it back and then some, I request that you grant this request. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gallagher. Anyone else would like to speak on this? You want to stay right there?
Yes, please. Okay. As a tell your private,
go ahead, ma'am. Tell who you are. Everybody doesn't know who you are.
I'm Lash Reitenberry. Okay. I'm a private citizen, and LabCorp is the New Day Western Electric. You see what happened to Western Electric? They left us. LabCorp has brought jobs to this county, to the city of Burlington, and I think it's a win-win situation to give them the incentives. I know it's an evil thing in one way, but if you don't do it, somebody else will. So I support an incentive for LabCorp, and I hope the management of LabCorp will talk to the Burlington City Council, and maybe they'll move the depot and open up Main Street and downtown Burlington will thrive again.
Thank you, Mr. Rogers. Is there anyone else in the audience that would like to make a comment? Mr. Bone? Yes, sir.
Madam Chairman, I don't have any comment with respect to LabCorp except to echo the comment about it being an outstanding corporate citizen. My concern is with the process of this particular incentive, and I'm wanting to understand, Madam Chairman, who negotiated the incentives package on behalf of the county?
The manager and the attorney.
And what, if any, role did Mr. Williams have in the process?
Not as much on this one. It was really using the template of what we've done in the past. He bought the incentive to us, but we negotiated directly with LabCorp.
the two of y'all negotiated with LabCorp.
Yes, sir.
At the last meeting, I believe it was, I'm sorry if my meeting sequence is out of order, I thought Mr. Williams came before the commissioners, before the board, to make a proposal, and I was under the impression from that appearance that he had negotiated the proposal.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Madam Chairman, I would, I'm glad to hear that is the circumstance of this negotiation. Because I'm concerned by some of the procedures that have taken place heretofore and may be taking place in other situations. But if that is, in fact, the situation, that makes it less onerous, even though I do disagree with the fundamental concept. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else would like to speak? If not, Ms. Vaughn would like to make a comment.
Well, like Mr. Boney said, they've been outstanding corporate citizens here in Alamance County for a long time. The investment of $27 million plus minimum tax that they would pay would be $143,717. After that, after we receive that tax, we would pay them $138,200 each year for 4 years. In other words, what we would see for 4 years, each year for 4 years, would be $5,000. After that, we would receive the full amount without anything going back to LabCorp as far as money going back. Is that correct, gentlemen? Yeah, and that's what I got from all this. So, you know, it's not that we're paying them anything out of the county coffers. It's money that comes from them first. We pay some of it back to them, and we do that for 4 years, each year for 4 years. We will see roughly $5,000 each of those 4 years. And then we would receive all of the tax benefit and not be paying back. It's a win-win situation, sir. Glad you're here. Thank you.
I just want to make a comment. I had Craig pull up some numbers today from past incentives that have been offered over the years. Mm-hmm. And if y'all will look at that, all of those have ended up bringing money back into the county.
Absolutely.
So I know we're going to give you an incentive, but hopefully you'll be here past 4 years, and that will increase our tax base. And as Bill said, by increasing the tax base, you can keep the tax rate down.
Well, I can't help but get in now.
Well, you look lonely.
I will recognize you.
No, I'm not lonely. I will assure you I'm a happy man. First of all, you're giving the direct innuendo that none of these companies would have come had you not given them the cash, and I don't think you can prove that, and I'd be willing to bet you that the majority of them would have come and still given us the tax revenue that they were lawfully billed. County attorney, will you please define what a tax abatement is and whether it's legal or not?
Tax abatements are not authorized under the North Carolina law.
Define it, please. What's a tax abatement?
An abatement of taxes is a forgiveness of tax. If I wanted to abate your taxes for a year, I couldn't do it.
That's illegal.
That's right.
Okay.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Oh.
Short and sweet.
I was waiting. Well, I'm thrilled that LabCorp is going to build this building because it will be an enhancement to Alamance County as far as I'm concerned, because houses don't bring in revenue like businesses do, and everybody knows that, and we're not building houses right now. So I appreciate everything you're doing. Okay. At this time, I will ask for a vote on the agreement.
I'll make a motion that we do the agreement.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
No.
Okay. I got you. And we'll come after you then. Now.
Thank you.
Okay, the next thing is the medical waste incinerator resolution. Ms. Sue Dayton, if you'll come forward, Sue, of the Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League. I do want to make one comment. There is a resolution in here that Ms. Dayton prepared. I know she got it from another county, but I did not realize that Alamance County did not prepare this resolution. I just want to make that clear to start with. When I got it, I was a little upset right. about it because I thought you were bringing the one from the other county. But instead, you typed it up for Alamance County and put our names on it.
Okay. Right. For your review.
Right.
So, good evening.
Good evening.
Commissioners and Chairwoman Massey. My name is Susan Dayton, and I'm an Alamance County resident, and I'm also a staff member with the Blue Ridge Environmental Defense League. And in terms of the resolution, I did actually send that information over to Mr. Honeycutt a few weeks ago. And since then, we've had a few more towns and cities sign on to the resolution. So I've actually revised it for your review, and I have copies of the new one. So I'd like to pass that out to you now. Okay. I think that the previous folks who were up at the microphone, Beverly Kerr and Heather Bjork and Dave Bjork, have really described what we're doing here with the Stericycle Medical Waste Incinerator. And not only will this resolution affect Alamance County residents and into neighboring counties, but it will also affect the residents of Matthews in Mecklenburg County, and that community has a medical waste incinerator known as the BMWNC Medical Waste Incinerator, and they are also fighting for clean air down there. I can tell you that the Matthews incinerator is half the size, but it's just as deadly in terms of toxic air pollutants emitted. And while it's true that, you know, these medical waste incinerators are legally operating, it's very true, and they must have a permit, it's actually, the permit is a license to pollute, because the air pollution control equipment cannot remove all of the air pollutants that are being emitted into the air from the incinerator. And both incinerators, both Stericycle and the BMWNC in Mecklenburg County, also have facilities where they use an autoclave, which is an alternative and a more environmentally friendly method of disposing medical waste. And they are, in both incinerators, being underutilized. And so we have a lot of work to do. But in the meantime, the Environmental Protection Agency, in 2009, last October, did adopt new standards, new and more protective standards for medical waste incinerators. And along with that, their requirements that they recycle and segregate waste, their requirements that the emissions from what's known as bypass events, and I might have talked about this last time I was here. The bypass events occur at medical waste incinerators when there's an operator error or something goes wrong with the pollution control equipment, when the stacks just open up and you have the release of unfiltered air pollutants, raw, dangerous air pollutants like mercury, like lead, mercury, cadmium, dioxins, furans, hydrogen sulfide, carbon monoxide, particulate matter, which, by the way, is directly linked with asthma. And so the Environmental Protection Agency requires medical waste incinerators to come into compliance with the rules by 2014. However, we're asking, because we know about the current levels of air pollutants that are being released from both incinerators, We're asking that you help us in adopting a resolution that asks the Environmental Management Commission of the state of North Carolina to require these medical waste incinerators to come into early compliance with the new EPA rules. And that is what you've heard, by 2012 instead of 2014. And please keep in mind that the EPA has now deemed the current releases of air pollutants by these incinerators unsafe. So by adopting the resolution, you are helping to ensure the clean air for our children and seniors, particularly children and seniors, for an additional 2 years. So I'm here tonight to ask you for your support and your assistance in this, and also if you have any questions that you'd like to ask me.
You and I talked, and you know, it comes out in the flow tonight. If the EPA knows the damage, why are they going to 2014? Why aren't they moved it to 12? I mean, it don't make rational sense to me. And when you and I talked about it, you said you really didn't know.
Well, some of the medical waste incinerators that are currently operating are actually in compliance with the new rules, and this is a standard time that they give to, you know, industry in this respect. We don't agree with it, and especially in the situation, because I can tell you right now, both incinerators are currently putting out emissions for some of the contaminants well over the new EPA standards.
And I also asked about the cost. How much would it cost for Stericycle to do it? Do you have any, you know, when we talked, you didn't have any idea.
To
go to the 2012 versus 2014.
I don't, Commissioner Sutton, I'm not sure what that amount would be, but I can tell you that the president and CEO of Stericycle, Mark Miller, is a multi-billionaire, as are some of his shareholders, and I don't think it would cause a, my personal opinion is, I don't think it would result in a great hardship. And I might also add that Stericycle has operated other medical waste incinerators in other communities in the United States, in other counties, and pressure from citizens has made them look to alternatives, and they've actually shut down their incinerators and replaced them with autoclaves.
Mm-hmm. Forgive me.
It's okay.
Even on vibrate, it makes noise.
Putting under
I'm losing my train of thought here. It's still making noise. Sit on it.
I wouldn't do that.
That was smother for sure. Okay. Here's my question. Were you here, was Blue Ridge here, and so forth and so on, when EPA or somebody set up monitoring for air? We claim this is in the air. When they were putting us on the emissions list for, you know, have your car inspected and they judge the quality of our air. Remember when that study was done several years ago? And they put us on, I mean, some counties had to go the extra mile for the auto emissions, some didn't because of the monitoring, mm-hmm. And I didn't know if you had.
I wasn't here at that time.
I don't know if you did.
We did, there was a group working under our organization, a chapter called GASP. And that chapter actually was successful in, they pressured the Division of Air Quality to require Stericycle to segregate dental waste from the medical waste. And that resulted in a dramatic decrease in mercury emissions.
What about the study? My last question. What about the study that came out years ago about the cancer rates down Hall River? In other words, it was water-related, Hall River-related versus air, and it was said that Bynum, where's Bynum? Chatham County?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That Bynum had one of the highest cancer rates, and that they got their water from the Hall River, and the the innuendo was that the Hall River was so polluted that that was causing mm-hmm. some cancers versus air.
Yeah, well, it's, you know, it's very difficult to make an association directly or direct link between, say, a medical, the emissions that are being released by a medical waste incinerator and an illness, because there are so many other compounding factors. But I can tell you that dioxins, in particular, and mercury, when they're emitted into the air, they fall to the ground and they get in the soil. And they get in surface waters. So dioxins are present.
I do have one more. I do a lot of work up around Blues Creek.
Mm-hmm.
What about that coal-burning plant there, the steam plant? What's Blue Ridge's opinion of that situation?
You know, I don't work on coal-fired power plants in the organization, so I can't answer that. If Lou Zeller was here, our science director, he could probably answer it for you. But coal-fired power plants do put out, you know, some of the same air toxics. The problem is with medical waste incinerators, they purposely burn plastics and paper, which contain chlorine and PVCs that result in the formation of dioxins and furans when they're burned. And this is highly toxic. And they simply don't need to do that. They simply do not need to burn plastics and paper. The paper can be shredded and recycled, and the plastics do not need to be incinerated. They can be recycled, and they should be. They should not be burned as fuel. And that's how the incinerator, that's why Mark Miller's a billionaire. That's how he does it. He cuts corners at the expense of our children's health and of every person in this room tonight.
Any more? You got a question in here?
No, I'm okay. The only real question I have is, I know, you know, I'm not opposed to doing this. The real question is what does it gain to get it in the timeline by us accepting it? Because the EPA is actually a federal regulated
mm-hmm.
thing.
Yes.
What does it gain?
Well, it gains us 2 years in children and seniors and all of us not being exposed to unsafe levels of air pollutants being released by the incinerators. And also, you would be joining Mecklenburg County, Chatham County, Orange County, which I know about that, the towns of Hillsborough, Carrboro, Haw River, and the city of Mebane in supporting this resolution. And we don't stop there. We're keeping going.
Mm-hmm. They did pass it.
Yep. Yes. And we have our both town councils and city councils here tonight.
Well,
so they did
question.
Pass it.
I mean,
yeah.
We have
a lot to gain. We have a lot to gain. We have a lot to gain if Alamance County joins, you know, with us in asking for early adoption of the rules, and the state can supersede the EPA on this, yeah. Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, they have to at least meet it. They have to at least meet it. But they can call for stricter standards. And that's what we would all like to see here.
I don't have any questions.
Dan?
No questions.
Thank you.
I have a question about where do all these towns take their, if they stop this or whatever, you know, where are they going to take it?
Oh, they wouldn't stop it.
Yeah, because I know Orange County takes everything they got.
Yeah, it would continue to be incinerated, and however, there would be new restrictions on the, you know, the air pollution control equipment, and they would be required to take out more of the contaminants from the air.
Well, the only problem I have is going over the federal guidelines. I have that problem that they mm-hmm. have given this company that, and I think it's you know, the company has not, we have not talked to that company at all, and they have not presented any evidence that you are right, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Or wrong, yeah.
Right.
So that's my problem in voting on this tonight.
I don't think we need to vote on it.
Tonight.
I just, you know, industry, private industry, is being attacked every day. I think there's a problem. There's a cancer problem in Alamance County. It's the number one killer for Alamance County citizens. But I don't think we need to be picking on any corporation that's got 4 years to get that done. I think 4 years is not a bad time to wait.
Can I make three comments?
No.
No, ma'am.
No,
no ma'am.
It was in response to his
no,
questions.
Ma'am. No, ma'am. Okay. No, ma'am. No, ma'am. Only
okay.
To mistake what we have.
Well, Commissioner Massey, let me respond to your question about...
Let me tell you one more thing first.
Okay.
And the reason I would like to hear from Stericycle before I vote on the resolution, I would like to...
Have they responded? I know you had a hearing at ACC. Have they been
right.
there to respond?
They were at the hearing, and they are free to submit comments to the Division of Air Quality as well.
Have they done any?
I am not sure. But in terms of who's right and who's wrong, these are the facts.
Well,
you know,
I mean, no. So I hope, you know.
Right. And we also know of other people that live close to it that have health problems and some very strange health problems, as I understand it.
Well, we hadn't heard from, I don't think I have.
Well, it's not for me to, you know, say. But what I want to say is in terms of the rules, the new EPA rules, they were adopted in 2009. And, you know, all this information is a part of the public record, and that, you know, the rules, the EPA is given the EPA is given medical waste incinerators until 2014 to come into compliance.
Exactly. That's
right.
My problem right there.
If they're smart, they'll do it beforehand.
Exactly. But I would like to hear from Stericycle. I don't know what anybody else's thoughts on it, but
well,
I would like to have them come and do a presentation for us before I vote on this. But I'm just one person.
Let me just say too that, you know, industry when industry is given a time limit, they'll usually take their time and, you know, act within that time limit, and not want to spend additional money before they have to. I mean, and that's just how business goes. Don't you think, Commissioner
Well,
Boswell?
I'm not totally against it. I just would like to hear from the other side.
All right.
Okay. Does anybody else have a problem with
that? The cost.
Yeah. Well, maybe we can just table this. And,
yeah. Can we just table this?
Put it on our agenda for.
Do I need a motion?
Next
time.
Yes, you do. I'll make a motion. We table it.
A motion. We table it.
No further information.
Have a second.
And put it on our agenda though to let them respond. I'll second.
Stericycle was. Called business was on the agenda, but they were not formally asked to come. With the wish of the board, would you like
me to send a formal invitation to them, have them come at our next meeting, and to make a presentation on this issue?
Yes, I have a motion and a second. All in favor of tabling this right now until we can have Stericycle? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. So we will.
Don't give it up.
We will bring them in,
yeah.
Ms. Day. Whenever they can, yeah. Yeah, at the next meeting. See if we can get them at the next meeting.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. I'll let you know as quickly as possible if they can.
Okay. Okay. The next thing on our agenda is the. Hall River Fire District Tax Increase, and if Mr. Earp will come forward, please. And tell everybody who you are now.
My name is Jeff Earp, and I'm the town manager for the town of Hall River. Madam Chair and Commissioners, thank you very much for the opportunity to come before you tonight as we try to justify to you our request for a 3-cent tax increase on our fire district tax. If you will allow a little latitude. Fortunately for every community, there's a group of concerned people who think not only of the present, but also of the future. Such is the case in 1957 when the Hall River Volunteer Fire Department was organized. Realizing the need and acting out of concern for the people and the property of the town, and knowing how devastating fire can be, a group of determined men worked together to provide Hall River with the town's first organized defense against fire. The Hall River Fire Department became a town department as the town was incorporated in 1973. Currently, our fire department is a paid and volunteer fire department. We have 3 full-time firefighters and approximately 35 volunteers. These men provide coverage for a fire district that is 14.45 square miles, of which the town is 2.66 miles. As you can tell from these figures, our fire district is roughly 20% within our city limits and 80% out. There's an estimated 2,846 parcels in our fire district, with 1,984 of them having buildings valued above $10,000, which are occupied. The fire department answers calls of every type imaginable. We do medical issues, vehicle wrecks, hazmat events, grass, forest fires, house fires, and even the occasional train wreck. If you look at our fire district on a per capita basis, the total population for the fire district is 6,058 people. The town of Hall River's population is 2,012. This translates into 33% of the population being within the town limits and 67% of the population outside the town limits. If you look at our fire district on a call basis, the Hall River Fire Department answered 702 calls from June 1, 2009 through May 30, 2010. During this period, 256 of the calls were within the town limits. At the same time, 446 of these calls were outside of our limits. That translates into 35% of the calls inside the town, 65% of the calls outside of our limits. As you can see from these facts and figures, a vast majority of our fire department activity and associated expenses are taking place in the portion of our district that is outside of our town. The Hall River Town Council believes that these expenses of the department should be paid equitably by the town and the outside fire district in direct correlation to the use. Our district is unique in the fact that we are predominantly residential with some commercial and a little industrial facilities. With that said, because of the interstate, because of mutual aid agreements with surrounding cities and towns, we have to be able to handle all kinds of events. A lot of people have said, you've got a lot of equipment. Well, we do. In order to have the training and equipment needed to be able to respond effectively to protect the citizens and property of the district, it requires a significant financial investment. The current operating budget request to the town council was $356,365.54. The requested budget received by the town council and the one submitted March 2010 to Alamance County does differ slightly, have some different figures. For one, the current budget does not, and may I repeat, does not, I understand this is an issue, have any monies requested for any salary increases. This does, however, increase funding for retirement system payments and health insurance costs that are associated with personnel that were mandated by the vendors. I think you're hitting the same roadblock with the North Carolina retirement or local government retirement system. And also, we took a 17% increase in health insurance premiums, and I'm sure you took an increase also. In order to equitably distribute the cost of the department, 34% of the revenues should come from town sources in an amount of approximately $121,164. And 66% of the revenues would come from the outside fire district in the amount of a fire tax. To a figure of around $235,201. In order to accomplish this tax rate attributed to the operating budget, the operating the fire tax would need to be set at 12 cents per hundred based on the fire district evaluation estimates supplied to us by the Alamance County Tax Department with a 95% collection rate. The Town Council of Hall River also asked that the Commissioners consider 1.5 cents of the evaluation to be set aside in a fund or a capital reserve fund in order to ensure that the town can replace equipment as needed. how do we use our equipment and what do we have? We currently have two engines, a tanker, a rescue squad, a utility truck, a brush truck is commonly known, a pickup and a Tahoe. The last piece of equipment we bought was in 2009. It was a engine. We paid approximately $380,000 sticker price. It will cost us close to $500,000 time the interest is paid in 10 years. What we replaced was a 1979 engine with a 2009. We scheduled 30-year replacement on our engines. As far as our squads go, the last one we bought was in 1997. We have it scheduled for replacement in 2017, 20 years. As far as our pickup trucks and those smaller vehicles, we have one that's a 2000 Tahoe and a 2005 pickup. We have those on 12 to 15-year replacement cycles depending upon mileage. It's not like we go out every year and buy new vehicles. We do try to get more than the standard useful life out of a vehicle, and we do that because we pride ourselves in the upkeep and maintenance. With all of that said, Commissioners, this request is made with an understanding that these are uncertain economic times and that no one wants to have a tax increase to burden any of our citizens, whether it be the town or the county. With that said, the Town Council does feel that the cost of these services should be equitably distributed so that the citizens of Hall River are not supplanting or supplementing the cost of the fire district for the outside. Thank you for taking your time to hear our request.
Thank you, Jim.
Anybody got any questions, Mr. Earp?
Yeah, I do. When, first of all, since I've been a commissioner, part of the issue with me has always been that fire taxes tend to go unchecked, or it's because they have their own boards and so forth, and there's not much protest, and it just seems to be more automatic than challenged or reviewed from our perspective. So I understand that we're going to have a process that does some overlooking, but when this was brought up, your fire department, Hall River, doesn't have a board like Eli Whitney does. It comes from the city council, right?
Okay. Yes, sir.
When y'all had your budget process, did anybody talk about this publicly, or the citizens, about having their taxes raised from 10.5 to 13?
The council has talked about this in just about every budget meeting we've had since April. Now, we have, last meeting we had about 70 at our most of our meetings. We have a crowd that is as big as for your council or for your commissioner's meeting. So I would say yes, the public has been informed. There have been newspaper articles, many of them. I've taken calls myself. My councilmen who are present have taken calls. We understand.
How's the public reacted, though? I understand you're saying you've responded, but how has the public responded at these meetings about this increase?
Would you like for our council to
answer
that?
A trend, if you can tell me if there's been a trend.
Mr. Boggs, would you like to address that?
This is our Mayor Bob, Buddy Boggs.
Hall River, Commissioner Sutton. The calls I've received basically from the citizens of Hall River not liking the idea that we are paying for the outside fire district. We're not getting enough money from the district to pay for the services we're providing. And the five or six calls I've got, we're against that. I have received no calls from anybody in the district where we're talking about raising the fire district tax.
What would the total budget be if I'm coming up with figure $417,000 would be the budget? Is that correct if the 13 cents went through?
For operating budget, you would have approximately $357,000 and about $43,000 going into a reserve.
Okay, for a total of?
Whatever, about four, a little over 400.
Okay, now, and this isn't scientific, but I see some trends here that do bug me a little bit. I asked for some stats on square miles, parcels occupied. What we got was a And that was black, by the way. I had to hold it up to the light to see what the categories were. But we had square mile category, had parcels category, we had vacant parcels category, occupied parcels categories, and 9-11 call categories for a total of 14 analogies that you could try to draw. And of the 14, as far as I can see, there are 11 of the 14 have more square miles than you. There are 12 that have more parcels than you. There are 12 that have more vacant parcels than you. There are 11 that have more occupied parcels than you. And there are 10 that have more 911 calls than you, based on what I'm looking at. And if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But that's,
we've got that from our GIS.
Right.
And the estimates from GIS.
And the last part of that would be, so I see a trend there that kind of stands out to me. But one of the other trends, and I think you can move this trend over to that trend and kind of fit it together. It might be some overlap, might be some illogical things ooze out of the cracks, but I see I think it would be contained fairly well that of the, there are 12, this is in our budget ordinance 2008-2009 here where it shows the per $100 valuation of all the fire taxes that are out there and the total assessed valuation. There are 12 analogies here that you can make. Of the 12, and you're included, 10, based on the $400-some thousand here that I'm looking at, 10 would have a lower budget than you, as far as what I'm coming up with. Now, I could be wrong. 10, I don't think I am, though. 10 out of 12 have a lower budget than you, yet the majority of those 10 have, in my opinion, more square miles, more parcels, more vacant parcels, more occupied parcels, and more 911 calls. So I don't know if, I don't know. Can you comment on what, if I'm wrong, obviously you can't say a whole lot academically, but except to say I'm wrong. But
sir, I learned a long time ago, numbers are numbers,
uh-huh.
And they can be analyzed many different ways. So you have your right to your analyzation, and I do not wish to comment on that.
Okay.
Tim, are you talking about the other fire districts in the county? Yeah. Is that what you're saying?
And it would be the highest rate of all of them, I understand.
Is that correct?
That is correct.
Yeah.
Any more questions?
Okay. Again, thank you, commissioners, for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Do we need that one?
We do. The tax rate does need to be set
for July 1.
And this was tabled from our last meeting as far as the budget ordinance.
Okay.
Right. So.
One other piece of information. The town council of the town of Hall River is holding a budget meeting Thursday in hopes of completing their budget. Currently, this is one of the issues that we do need to be addressed because it does have a significant impact.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Madam Chairman, can I understand what the proposed rate is, 12 cents?
No, 13.
13. 13 cents. And where does that compare to all other fire districts in Alamance County?
It would be the highest rate in the county.
All right. And Madam Chairman, if I remember right, but I want to be sure of this, last year when the county changed its property tax rate to be revenue neutral, and I realize there's a certain amount of issue in conjunction with that, but it changed its property tax rate, but I do not believe most of the fire district rates were changed.
I don't have a clue.
In particular, Hall River was not changed, was it?
No.
And so in essence, Hall River got, I'm going to call it a windfall, by virtue of the property revaluation last year already.
Now, Mr. Bunny, it's not a public hearing. You know that, don't you?
I understand the procedural.
Go ahead.
But in other words, isn't that correct?
That is correct.
I mean, the windfall is an opinion phrase, but in terms of it
there
did
no
in fact
adjustment of the tax rate.
Okay, to lower to account for the revaluation.
Right.
And I believe you said that there were only two districts that did, in fact, have any adjustment. Okay.
Okay. All right. So do I hear a motion that we, on this issue?
Before we vote, can you explain to us where we are and what you're looking at doing with the analogy of all the departments and so forth?
What came out of our last meeting was, as Commissioner Sutton mentioned, is there's really not an oversight process from this board when this board is asked to set a fire district tax. It's pretty much been rubber stamped, for lack of a better word, through the past history of Alamance County. After that meeting, I met with our fire marshal, Dave Leonard, and Tim Burgess, myself, and we sat down and trying to look at, is there a process that we can come up with, making sure that the public is aware, is there a time frame that all this needs to be done, and making sure that the commissioners are in the loop on the whole process. One of the things at our last meeting when we had our budget public hearing, it's one of those things, fire district tax sometimes can get glossed over. If I didn't mention during the meeting that there was a tax increase, it may have been glossed over, not because it's not a pressing issue. But what we're seeing is that it is a pressing issue, that you do want to be aware of taxes and any increases. The plan that we have is after the first of the year is to, once the 800 system is finally up and running, is meet with the fire chiefs, get some input from them on what is a good way to do some overview and some oversight, especially when somebody is asking for a tax increase. And is there a process that is involved, that the public is involved beforehand, making sure that the district members are involved in the process as well. So we haven't come up with that. We haven't come up with how we can come up with a baseline, but we are talking about it, and we're going to meet with the fire chiefs early or late summer, early fall, hopefully to have you a recommendation this fall.
Okay. We are floor is open for a motion.
I guess our motion is to accept their increase or not, basically, is what you're saying. And then how does that affect our already established tax rate? I mean,
it affects this district's tax rate. The most be for the Hall River Fire District. Again, the budget was passed at the last meeting. This was the only section that was pulled out.
Right.
Okay.
We did pull this out.
I'll make a motion that we go ahead and accept this with increase.
Okay. Have a motion on the floor to accept this. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. All opposed?
No.
All right. The next thing on our agenda is to set a public hearing for Community Development Block Grant Projects. Jason Martin.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packet two memorandums to set public hearings. The first one is for the 2007 Scattered Sites Community Development Block Grant. That was a grant that we were awarded in 2007 for $400,000 to conduct housing rehabilitation for low to moderate income residents in the county. All the work has been completed on that project, and we are now prepared to close out the grant. As part of the closeout process, we have to hold a public hearing, and staff recommends setting the public hearing for Monday, July 19th at 7 p.m. And on the second item is a request to set a public hearing for community development block grant funding. This is just a generic public hearing to inform the citizens of how grant funds can benefit the county and the county's intent to actively pursue those grants, and also what type of projects grant funds can be applied for. Okay. And we also recommending setting the public hearing for Monday, July 19th at 7 p.m. for that as well.
Okay. Do I hear a motion that we
now, can we do both of those in the same motion, or is that
Should be, because they're both on the same day.
Okay, I don't know.
We did.
Calendar.
Probably that week, we're still doing both at the same one time. Okay.
Ann made a motion.
Ann made a motion.
I'll second that.
And this is for scattered sites for $400,000, and the other one is 20 money on that one, is it?
Yeah, there's not, that's just to express intent to apply for grants. It gives us the ability to apply for more, for funding.
Have a motion on the floor?
And a second.
And a second, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
No opposed? Okay, you got that one.
I mean, I agreed with y'all on something.
Yes, you did.
No, we agreed with you.
Yes, you did. Okay.
I believe I'm still up.
Still up for Jordan Lake Hills.
Okay, and also in your packets, you should have a memorandum from me kind of explaining the state, amended Stage 1 Adaptive Management Plan for the Jordan Lake Rules. This is just to kind of refresh the board's memory. This is the management plan that was submitted back in December of 2009. We received word that the state had recommended denial of our adaptive management plan, and then we received confirmation that they had denied it. It was rejected on May 13, 2010. And it's my understanding that the reasoning behind the rejection really had nothing to do with the subject matter in the plan, but it was, they wanted some more specifics about timeframes and specifically what are we doing. So you should have here an amended copy with highlighted sections that are changed. There's very minimal changes to this. Particularly, most of this is just some tables at the end of it. I will point out specifically under task number 3 on page 2, there's a highlighted section there regarding identification and removing of illicit discharges and failing on-site wastewater systems. The state had requested from us what specific authority do we have to address failing septic systems, and I spoke with Carl Carroll in the Environmental Health Office, and he had given me this general statute, specifically Article 11, Chapter 130A of the North Carolina General Statutes, and 15A NCAC 18A.1900 of the North Carolina Administrative Code. And then there is another under task number 5, develop a program to ensure maintenance of BMPs implemented by the county. I added a statement at the bottom of this that should it become necessary to implement a Stage 2 adaptive management plan, which is what they're referring to when they talk about retrofitting. As detailed in the Jordan Lake Rules, Alamance County will develop policies and procedures to ensure that BMPs owned and operated by the county are properly maintained. As of this time, the county, to my knowledge, does not own or operate any stormwater BMPs. This would be developed at the earliest in year 5 of the Stage 1 adaptive management plan. The logic behind that is that at the absolute earliest that we would have to implement a Stage 2 adaptive management plan would be 2017, as opposed to the other arm of the Jordan Lake, they have to implement in 2014. So but we've been asked to detail out specifically what we would do, which is the appendices, at the end of the document here for public outreach and education. These are things that we already do or that we are already planning to do. Okay. So there's no increased costs involved. We have a partnership with the Piedmont Triad Water Quality Partnership that distributes educational materials. You've probably seen some of their commercials on TV. Right now their big one is the pet waste commercial. And then Appendix B, stormwater mapping. Right now we don't have any stormwater BMPs, so there's really no need to map it. But as if we have to put those in, then we would map them in GIS and have that information readily available for them. Again, I set that out at year 5. The illicit discharge, conducting in-house training for select employees through environmental health, which I have covered this with environmental health, and they were okay with it. Inform the general public regarding the hazards of illegal discharges and improper waste disposal. And then also to develop a streamlined mechanism for reporting, particularly through the website, so that people see illicit discharges, that they can report that to environmental health. And then the last one there for BMP operations and maintenance. So The planning board has reviewed this. They did vote unanimously at their meeting on June 10th to recommend approval. With your approval tonight, I will send this to the state. At that point in time, we start the process again. They have 6 months to review it. The Environmental Management Commission will either reject or accept it. If they reject it again, we will have 3 months to take their recommendations and go back and make changes a second time. So, and I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time.
No, I sat through all that discussion already.
Pretty lengthy one.
No questions, I guess. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Okay, the next thing is Mr. Leonard going to report on the Amtrak derailment.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, coming for you tonight just to give you a little briefing on what took place on May 13th, 2010. As you were aware, that morning starts off just about like pretty much any other morning. Downtown Melbourne, it just so happens what took place around 7:45 changed Melbourne considerably, especially for that day. On May 13th is when the train derailment took place, and since then we've been working a lot for lessons learned and things of that nature. We've actually had one critique that took place on May 28th. We will be having another one, and I'll speak more about that shortly here in just a few minutes. But just to give you a little overview of what took place that day, at 7:45 on May 13th, this is what was taken from a young lady's camera as she sat at this intersection watching the driver of this flatbed truck trying to remove his trailer that was lodged there on the rail. This was at 7:45 a.m. on this particular day. At 7:49 a.m., this was the scene that took place after the Amtrak train, which was estimated hitting this particular unit at 59 miles an hour. That's what the Amtrak officials told us that particular day. The ensuing fire that took place is a result of this when the locomotive's fuel tanks ruptured. They were carrying roughly 1,900 gallons of fuel when it left Raleigh that morning. Had approximately 1,000 gallons of fuel leak out into the area around the tracks and subsequently caught fire from the accident. As you see here, Mebane's firefighters are getting ready to make their initial attack. And I'll speak a little bit briefly in a few more slides as to what took place on their fire attack and how they approached it. Here's another picture as they are progressively trying to suppress the fire. And after the fire was extinguished, this is the aftermath. This is the locomotive. You see the flatbed trailer there that was actually lodged underneath the locomotive as it progressed down the tracks. This is another aerial view. If you'll notice the area, a point of impact, there's very little ground disturbance from here to where that particular caterpillar that was on that flat boy landed. It's estimated it was in airborne approximately 70-some feet in airborne when it landed. It landed at such a hard pace, it knocked the track out, and the little red pickup truck that's up there on the top of your screen there is where that track underneath that that piece of machinery ended up. It knocked it out from under it, and it landed underneath that vehicle. This is a good aerial view showing what the scene looked like from up above. You can see the workers and crews that are there taking. Again, this was from another aerial view showing the actual tractor trailer. And again, if you'll notice this area right here is where the impact was taken, and it's 70-some feet over to where that landed. Close up of the tractor, it actually split. It was a low boy trailer, and it actually took half of it off. And this is the result of the caterpillar as it was hit. It was a brand new piece of equipment, less than about 200 hours on this piece of equipment. It flew 76 feet from the point of impact and landed there. The rear of the trailer, obviously, like I said, rode down the tracks. It actually lifted it up and took the trees out as it was going down the side of the track. The Amtrak train was leaving Raleigh, heading to Charlotte. It was one locomotive. one lounge or dining car, two passenger cars. We had 36 passengers on board, three crew members, and roughly, like I said, 1,900 gallons of fuel of diesel when it left Raleigh. There were seven people injured and transported to Alamance Regional Medical Center on the initial transport. Two injured passengers were transported to UNC Hospital, and two injured passengers were transported to Duke University Hospital. And one injured passenger, at the time this was done, was still hospitalized, but he was only in for 1 week. He was in for 1 week when we made the slide presentation up. He suffered a little bit more significant injury. It was not life-threatening. They caught it in time and was able to do surgery. Mevin's demographics, just a little bit about them. It's roughly a population of 11,474 people and 5.85 square miles. This is what's impressive right here. You saw that ensuing fireball that erupted on the initial impact of that train. When Mebane was dispatched, they were getting multiple calls to our CCOM downstairs stating there had been an accident, a wreck, a fire. Multiple calls were being received down there. It was inundating them. 11 firefighters responded on the initial attack for this fire. 11 firefighters and two police officers. They were your first line, first in for emergency service people that were on the scene at that time. Throughout the day, we recorded over 226 workers came to this scene from various agencies. And here are some of the agencies listed. Mebane Police Department, Alamance County Sheriff's Office, Graham Police Department, Mebane Fire Department, Hall River Fire Department, Alamance County EMS, Alamance County Fire Marshal's Office. We had numerous individuals from Norfolk Southern Railway and Amtrak Railway, the Norfolk Southern Railway Police, hazmat response crews, Transportation Security Administration, the TCA, the federal government was here also as well. North Carolina Department of Environment and Natural Resources, we had a large fuel spill, so their team was dispatched. North Carolina DOT Rail Division and the North Carolina DOT Maintenance Division, as well as Alamance Regional Medical Center was on site that day. The North Carolina State Emergency Management was on site. Our Red Cross chapter here in Alamance County was outstanding during this entire event. They provided any type of need that we could have possibly have wanted throughout the day for refreshments and nourishments. Alamance County governmental officials came to assist us and provide anything that we would need throughout the day from our county manager and assistant county manager. We had numerous Mebane city officials. It happened directly in front of Mebane's town hall. They opened their doors up for all of our people to come in. To get out of the elements, to cool off a little bit. Alamance County MIS was very instrumental. We'll talk briefly about that in a few seconds, as well as the Mebane City Public Works. This is just a little overview of where the accident took place here at 5th Street. As a result, we ended up down here at 4th Street from the impact. Our command vehicle, as you've seen out front, We had just received that vehicle that day. It had arrived in town that morning, roughly 3:30 that morning. So we left that earlier that day on the 12th to go to Columbus, Ohio to pick this particular unit up. As you are aware, I came before you many a times about the grant that we had written here in the county to receive this vehicle and some of the additional equipment and things that we came back to add to this vehicle. So this was our shakedown cruise, our first run of it, and it put it to the test. It really did. Like I said, it had been in town roughly 5 hours when this call was received. And these are some of the pictures inside. With all the technology and things, and that's where our MIS department was very crucial. When we have large events like this, we have individuals bringing in their technology. Is it compatible with what we have? Can we work it? So we utilized our Alamance County MIS people to assist us. Plus, all this equipment was new to us. Chuck Mancellus and I had received training on it in Columbus, Ohio on the 12th, turned around and brought it back home and had to put it into use that day. We were able to video, get a lot of good footage of the scene with the telescoping boom that's on the back of it. We can use in our training efforts and also in how we're assessing our areas as well to keep our people out of harm's way. So we have that capabilities on this particular unit as well. Basically, when we arrived on the scene, our emergency management office, we set up an instant command. And I will truly tell you that day, everything flowed as well as it could have. We had a great instant commander from our fire side, from our EMS side, and our law enforcement side. And that's a result of all the training that they have received and the dedication that they have for emergency services. So when you pull it all together, all the pieces of the puzzle came together that day. It could not have been an easier day from the emergency management side to manage this. A lot of positives came out of this. We were very fortunate that this rail car wasn't full of elementary kids on a field trip that day, as we've seen around that time of year. We were very fortunate that we had Alamance County Regional Medical Center staff available to us. We had a very good system in place for our Alamance Rescue and EMS to respond and to transport these. We're centrally located with a lot of real good hospitals and trauma centers that we could take any critically injured person to. So again, a lot of things came together that day, and it makes us very proud to say that what the emergency service people did for Alamance County that day was above and beyond the call. And I'd also like to say that the town or the city of Mevin really stood out that day and shined brightly. They provided us, like I said, with nourishment, refreshment all day long, three full meals all day, and into the night they stayed with us. They opened up their businesses. You could not have asked for any more better care from the citizens providing us that day, and for that we are truly thankful. Any questions or comments about what we did that day? As you've seen downstairs, outside we have the mobile command unit down there. It's still going to be there after the commissioners meeting tonight. We would welcome anyone to please take a tour of it. We're still adding a little bit of equipment to it. We're very proud of it. It's for the entire county. It's for any emergency service use that we can, you know, that we have throughout. We hope we never have to use it, but as it was proven that day, it worked very well for us. It was very beneficial to all the emergency agencies that had to utilize it.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Very good job.
Very good job. Okay, next is Mr. Burgess, please. Talk about Pleasant Grove Gym renovation.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. Yeah, before you tonight, a request to enter into a contract with Central Builders for the renovations to Pleasant Grove Gymnasium. The amount of their contract is $168,090. We would also ask to be able to include a contingency of $16,810 for a total of $184,900. These renovations will be paid for with the remaining insurance proceeds from the fire that happened at Pleasant Grove. Any money that remains from the insurance proceeds plus what's left over from the modular project will be used to do some further renovations to the gym, such as put in the gym flooring, possibly some interior painting, and some other things that may need to be done there. So tonight we ask for you to approve a contract with Central Builders so we can move forward with that project.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
You have the total amounts in here. What will the architect's total cost be for this?
The contract for that part, let's see, I think it was $24,500 was the architect's fee for this design work. It originally started out what they had, the original bid price was $231,500, which was outside of what we had had enough funds to pay for, so we had them scale that back. But we had a set fee with them. It wasn't based on a percentage of the bid price. That was on this, and we had them do some, and I don't have the numbers with me, but we had them do some earlier work for us, that, and they, I think they came and did a presentation to the community out there at Pleasant Grove that was a more elaborate project, which we did not have the funds to do, and so we had to incur some architect's costs there. But on this particular contract with them, I think it was $24,500 for the fees, design fees, and then they had some reimbursables that were less than $1,000 also.
What kinds of things would be included in those reimbursables?
That's copying charges, things like that, mileage reimbursements. And I think what we've, and I don't have the numbers with me, but I think so far it was, less than $1,000 what the reimbursables were.
Yeah, I noticed it in some other areas. And do we have any oversight on those reimbursables?
Well, the reimbursables, I think at this point, and again, I don't have them with them, but I think it may have been printing cost, and they do send in the receipts from wherever they got the printing done, because they handled the bid process, so they had to take all of the bid documents and get them copied to be able to send them out to the different companies that were interested in bidding. And so that's the kind of stuff that they would incur out-of-pocket cost on.
Any more questions?
Tim, let me ask you something. When say we're going to replace a roof on one of the county buildings.
Yes, sir.
Do we need an architect to do that?
There is.
What do y'all do when you?
Okay, when we and going back several years back, when we contracted with the architectural firm to do the renovations to the buildings, they and the engineers that they used to do the roofing, they went out and assessed the roofs to determine what type of repairs had to be done to these roofs. And these roofs, as you well know, they're not the shingled roof like you would have on a house. Yeah. They're, some of them actually have concrete up under the materials, that, and so there can be several layers of different types of building materials. The engineer goes through and assess what types of repairs need to be made to make sure that these roofs last as long as they have to. Now, as far as having to contract under state law, if the repairs are over a certain dollar amount, then you end up having to get either an architect or an engineer involved in these projects. And this is kind of more in the scope of overall the facility improvement plan that we're doing.
What is that dollar amount?
Yeah, I don't have it with me, and it depends on whether it's a life and safety issue or whether it's new construction or whether it's renovations. And so I'm not sure. I don't have those dollar amounts with me, so I'd hate to even state what they are.
On that roofing package, was that lumped in as one total thing?
We had three different roofing projects. We had one that was on part of HSC, which was the largest one altogether. It was all but the same-day surgery wing. The same-day surgery wing was a project in itself, which the same-day surgery, what was called the old same-day surgery wing, which is where mental health is housed and also social services. That project and this building and the building that's connected to us, all of that, if not mistaken, was one project. The HSC, the remainder of HSC, was another project, and then we've got the Register of Deeds and the ACTA building, and I think maybe Central Permitting may be another contract that was done. So altogether, we had three different roofing projects as far as bundles.
I'm going to follow on Bill's line of questioning there, because could we not just put an engineer on staff and eliminate some of this? I mean, is that a potential?
Well, we're basically all in another 2 months, we'll probably be through with all the roofing projects.
Right.
And we have done.
But in the future, if you run into a situation like that, I don't know. It just seems like we've spent a lot of money.
Roofs are very complicated. I was over the roofs at Laurelark Tobacco Company, and roofs are very complicated.
They on commercial buildings.
You need an engineer to decide, but there's more things than just replacing a roof. Roofs are complicated.
There are, and I'd rather have, and I could have the architect come and explain the, and give you a much better explanation than I can as far as the difficulty in repairing these roofs. But you go over to HSC, and there are several different roofs over there based on, if you go there and look, it's not just one.
You got all different types of roofs.
Yeah, roofing materials and all that. And these roofs, by having them done right, they should last us possibly 25 or 30 years.
Well, a lot of manufacturers give you a really good warranty, whether they're done by an engineer or not.
Right, and one of the difficulties is, and this is just one of the aspects of the whole process, but when we go out, and this is by state law, when we go out to bid these projects out, we have to have somebody put together the bid package, which has to be very detailed as to what's going to be done, so that everybody that's bidding on the project will be bidding on the exact same thing.
Right.
If we just go out and call in three different roofers and say, tell me what you charge to put a roof on this building, well, all of them are going to come back with different specifications as to what they would do. And therefore, we haven't really complied with it, because we're not comparing apples to apples. And so the engineer goes in, determines what would be the best method to replace this roof, and then they go in and prepare the specs, and then we bid that, or the architect handles out the bidding out of that project for us. So to make sure everybody's bidding on the same thing.
So if we run into roof failure, where do we go?
We'll go back to the architect, because the architect, the fees that the board approved to pay to the architects then turn around and they're paying the engineers to do the engineering work on them. We're not paying a fee in addition to the architect, but the architect, part of their fee is covering the cost of the engineers.
So they're taking on the liability of that roof, is that what you're saying?
The architect should, and the engineers. So if we have roof failures, we'll go back to the architect.
You have to make sure that those roofs are put down and different degrees of different standards. Somebody has to be there to make sure that roof is putting the roof on like it's called for.
Right, and the engineer was here at our weekly meetings. They were here on a weekly basis to make sure that the roofs were being put on correctly. In addition to them, the manufacturer comes in to make sure they're put on correctly for a warranty purpose. So if you have problems with the roofs, we'll go back to the architect or go back to the contractor to make sure that any of those problems are remedied.
Can you give me that number, that figure from Raleigh or wherever about
the limits
yes.
for an architect?
Yes. In fact, I can give that to you at the end of the meeting. If you want me to come back up, I can give those dollar amounts to you. I can get that from my office.
I want those, and we'll have that for you.
Be glad to.
Madam Chairman, I could answer that.
Well, let's let Mr. Burgess do it.
Yeah, let's finish this.
And if you will get that for us.
And I'll be glad to have that later in the meeting for you, yes. Okay. And I can give those numbers to you.
All right.
I had one more question. I guess we're done with the insurance on that. Is that correct, Clyde?
Yes.
So you totaled out. Got them for all you could?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Anything that's just your report, right?
We need a motion to approve the contract.
Oh, okay.
With Central.
I'll make a motion that we accept the contract.
Got a motion for Central Builders. Second. Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next thing on our agenda is the Orange County Line issue. Mr. Albright.
Fire Rock. Bill. Orange County, Alamance County, Orange Line. Bill has survived the Senate. It has been passed by the Senate and is now in the House Judiciary Committee. The Senate version of the bill is in the House Judiciary Committee, which we understand we'll be taking that up either tomorrow or Wednesday, maybe tomorrow, for the second reading. Then if it survives there, it'll have a third reading, and then at the third reading in the House will become law. Since it's a local bill, the governor doesn't have to sign it. And having said that, if it does meet that third reading, and we believe the indications are that it will, we'll be required to have a petition process in place on or before August 1st of this year under the legislation, where we have to have a system to get put together so that affected property owners, first of all, we identify who they are, and then give them a way to petition. And Bruce has put together a PowerPoint presentation that will walk you through that process.
Good evening. It's been a long road up to this point. Literally, we've all driven in the van before. Just some recent history. Back in November, we had the joint meetings, and we got some direction from the boards. In January, a manager's memorandum of understanding. There was many, many staff meetings to go over this process. You know, we had a final overall joint staff meeting in April to kind of finalize some results and get a consensus. In May this year, approved the joint county local bill, as you guys, and it's about to go through state legislature. And then at the same time, on May 18th, the Orange County Board of Commissioners approved this criteria and timeline. So I'll just go right into it. Again, it's a compromise from back in the fall. The majority of the process is a straight line from the North County Geodetic Survey. Probably does not qualify as part of the petition process. County line change would be split by the North County Geodetic Survey line and would be taxed in both counties based on the percentage split. The second methodology, which is the criteria, is county line adjustment for people who qualify and then get a letter and petition it, and then are jointly approved by this board and the Orange County Board in the fall as be part of an official change of the line in those areas. We tried to keep it very, very simple, and our focus from your direction of that meeting was to focus on existing homeowners and businesses that are reasonably close to North County Geodetic Survey line, and it would be directly affected or moved by that line. So there's three basic parts of the criteria. The first part is home business and lots within 150 feet on either side of the line. That would change counties would qualify to petition. With this caveat, lots less than 1.8 acres all the if they petitioned and were approved, the whole property would be put in because it's a small lot. If it's a large lot, I mean, some farms and stuff have a very large lot. Again, we're accommodating their house, their home, up to the 150-foot buffer. You can't do the whole thing or you're going to get that zigzag process. Criteria two was, and this is something Orange County worked with and we agreed to, lots less than 1.8 acres, but the home wouldn't move, but they're being split by the line, they could petition to have the whole property in. Okay. And the third criteria was, we came to consensus in the very southern part of the county where Cane Creek completely isolates some property, they would qualify to petition as well. So we try to keep it very simple so that people can understand. That produces about 122 people that can petition out of the process to stay where they are. And that's 67 people in Orange County, 55 in Alamance County. There is the issue of Collington Farms, where there was a dual taxation situation. The developer, before they built homes, paid taxes to both counties, four or five properties. Okay. So in that case, there may be a situation where we're going to allow those people to say what they want. There could be a situation where one person isolated out as an island says they want to be something and the others don't. In that case, we may have to come in and make a recommendation that we can't do that because you can't have an island as part of the county. Let me give you some examples visually. We all traveled in the northern part of the county in Eliza Lane. Okay, all these parts are in Orange County right now. The light orange is, you can see the black line is the North County Geodetic Survey line. The purple lines are the 150-foot buffer. The people to the left are being moved from one county to the other, the house, so they would be allowed to petition. Every one of those could decide if they want just let it stand or be part of staying in Orange County. The people at the bottom, the two brownest orange, their house actually still is in Orange County. Okay, the two bottom parts right there. But they'd be allowed to petition because it's a small lot to have their whole property in. Most likely they won't because they're going to have to pay for that. Their tax values will go down. You know, we looked at the worst case scenario and every possible scenario if everybody petitioned. My prediction is not everybody will. This is the Mill Creek area. These people were Alamance County citizens. The line splits them and puts them in orange. They'd be allowed to be put into Alamance County. Okay. If they, again, they have their say, they have a letter, they petition us now. Ninth Street area, almost all the people in Ninth Street would be accommodated. They're within one block of the North County Geodetic Survey line. This is one of the more complicated subdivisions, the best property in the southern part of Alamance Orange. All the people in orange and brown, again, the bright orange, they could have their whole property in. Same thing with the brown, but they still would be in Orange County. The blue property at the very bottom is Alamance, and they could have the very edge of their property put in. Okay. This is a farm. I wanted to make sure, you know, Orange County did some presentation on 18th, and they didn't show some of the farmers. This is a couple farms right here where everything is in orange. The two properties on the left, that's a very large tract of land. So they would be up to that purple line that they could stay in Orange County, and then the rest would be split off. The orange property at the bottom is less than 1.8 acres, so they could have the whole property in. Property on the eastern side, it would just be the very corner at the top. Now, I have actually talked to this farmer, and they're welcoming. They really want to be in Alamance County, so they're welcome to change. Again, this is every possible scenario. A lot of people know the tax differences, and you know, I don't think 122 people are going to petition in this process. This is Collington Farms, like I was telling you about. All those properties right there, we've discovered that subdivision paid taxes in both counties at the times when they were lots and then developed them, and they're all filled. So you've got some overlap there, and that may be a situation where if somebody in the very end wants to stay orange but everybody wants to be Alamance, we can't, for safety reasons, allow that, and we would have to come back to you and show that to you. Again, we want to give at least people a say, and this is probably the only scenario, the only thing where we may have to change what people say for safety.
What about that one that's right on the fourth
one? This one?
That one
is in orange except for the very edge of it, and they're part of that. Again, if it splits it, they're allowed to make a decision on that.
Jeez.
Okay, we don't have that map.
I think
packet. It's not in the packet.
It's not in the packet.
Okay. I'm sorry. I can get that to you. It's in the previous map that I've given to you. Anyway, this is the Cane Creek eastern side of the peninsula. Their access is over here. The river's right here. The bridge is way, way up north. Again, these people would qualify to stay in Orange County. They're currently being taxed in Orange County. This is just a working, evolving timeline. And again, as Clyde had said, we need to have a petition process in place by August 1st. We've worked countless hours on this. It's a consensus from both staffs and county management. We tried to help everybody we could. We looked at all the people who came to the public hearings and how many people this would affect. It affects the vast majority of them, and they would get essentially what they wanted. So what are the next steps? If you approve this criteria and this process is approved, then we send joint letters to the public almost immediately. We're working to get finalized this week, send out by August 1st. Help petitioners through the process. You know, again, in Alamance County, we got 57 petitioners. We're going to put on a letter, come in and let's walk you through it. I mean, it's complicated. They may not be able to read the map or whatever. We're glad to do it. That's our job. Board of County Commission petition hearings in the fall will create a packet for you of the people who actually petition to stay in their county. We'll give that all to you. We can go on a one-by-one basis, or you can vote the whole thing up and down. Like the 9th Street group can put in a petition altogether. It doesn't have to each individual. Once that process is approved by you guys, then the petitioners have to pay for the survey, which is part of the official submission to Raleigh. You know, certain subdivisions it won't cost as much, other people it will cost more, but that was part of what we initially talked about, that the citizens would, again, this is a one-time deal. It makes it official. They won't have to anything to worry about in the future. It won't be 5 years from now or anything like that.
All right. One question. You mentioned 9th Street. Could all of 9th Street, if they wanted to,
hire one surveyor?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely.
And that would split up the cost, and of course, lower it.
It would be on the petition form, they would have like a representative, and they would represent all those people.
If that's what they wish to do.
They
have until May 15th, if the bill passes the way it's written, to get that survey to Raleigh
next year,
right?
2011,
right?
Since May 11th,
and
gone.
You know, we've been talking North County Geodetic Survey. They will review every survey to make sure it's compliant. They will write up a list. Once we get to that point, we'll hand people to give to their surveyors this list of requirements, which ties into the North County Geodetic Survey. So basically, it'll be coming down the line and going around in a few little spots. And again, in the extreme case where we have to deny a petition, like in the Collington Farms, if that actually happened, then we may have to pay for part of that survey just in that area, which would be a minimal cost. But I want to let you know that it could possibly happen. And again, December, we'd have a joint resolution for Reconciled County Line that both boards would have to approve based on your approval of the new county line. And the legislature would vote the county line the following year. And the Reconciled County Line would take effect January 1st, 2012. And again, I can't emphasize enough how much work has gone into this compromise. And it is a compromise, but I'll take any of your questions now, Claude and I.
Any questions?
Yeah. How come you're not showing the hypothetical zigzag that will exist if any or and or all are approved? I mean, I like to, you know, see the reality of the zigzag that we're going to be.
I can get you a copy of that. I did for staff. We made a map so you could see it. It's about as long as this table to show, because it's so small, the difference. Because 150 feet isn't a lot when you look at the whole county line. Mm-hmm. So it virtually looks straight. If you saw on the TV news, on the weather, when you watch the weather where the storm's coming, you would hardly see it, if at all. So I certainly can get that. I have it downstairs. I didn't really know where to hang up this large map.
It's like a scroll.
Yeah, it's kind of a scroll. I'd be glad.
I understand there's going to be something where it's going to be minute like that, but I assume there's going to be some also on the other side, some extreme zigzagging.
Well, that's where the 150-foot limitation is.
It's only 1.8 acres.
Yeah.
If you do that in Orange, they have subdivision ordinance.
Yeah. So even on the large tracks, they only can go up to 150 foot. We focused on the buildings and the families and the people that are there that would be displaced. There's plenty of other people that are vacant land that are going to be split based on this North County Geodetic Survey line. It's not a normal thing to happen. It happens all the time in counties and in cities. So be glad to show you the map.
I like to see it.
Okay.
If I may add,
we haven't started our discussions with Guilford yet. We wanted to talk to you about this process first. Get your feel as to the petition process. If you'd like for us to go forward along these lines as Orange has, we'll approach Guilford with the same suggestion.
I'm for that.
I'm for that too.
Yeah. And I think Guilford is too. I talked with some last week at the college. And they're ready.
I was really surprised. And you're talking about 122 properties. Certainly not that many. 10 years from now, if we don't do anything, it might be 1,200 properties. So now's the time to do
it. We're ready. Ain't we ready? Never mind. Okay. Well, thank you so much.
I'd
make a motion. We follow through with this.
Go ahead and send this to Guilford.
We need to make it on this. Approve of the process to allow for the petition.
Okay.
And then once it's approved, it's already been approved by the Orange County Board. We will begin the process of trying to get out the information to the property owners as quickly as possible to help them walk through the process.
I have a motion on the floor.
I'll make a motion that we follow through with the petition.
And second, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
No.
Next thing on our agenda is the budget amendments from DSS.
Good evening.
Hello.
I'll be quick. The first one that you have, Budget Amendment 168, is the second allocation from our TANF Emergency Contingency Funds. I think I was here about 6 weeks ago with the first $18,000. This actually is funding that was made available to 25 counties on an application process. We're putting 6 people to work. 3 are working for the county. 3 are working with nonprofits. They're paid with subsidized federal money. These are Work First recipients that would be getting a welfare check, but instead of that, they're going to work, building a resume, building some self-confidence. So this is just a budget amendment to put in the second allocation of these funds. Right now, this program is scheduled to go through September 30th. One is placed with Richard Hill in maintenance. We have 2 at DSS doing scanning and 3 in the community.
Did we vote on the first allocation?
Yes, sir. We did.
Mm-hmm.
It's 4-1.
Yeah.
Don't change that.
I want to make sure I didn't screw up tonight.
Do I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment?
Move.
Have second. A motion and a second. All in favor say aye. All opposed?
No.
Two noes.
That's right. Bill wasn't here.
That's right. He wasn't here then.
Hey, I picked up a little.
The second budget amendment is 171. This is what we would consider a federal performance-based award. This is $63,000 that's coming to Alamance County DSS. Due to the staff's work in achieving permanence for children in foster care, these funds are 100% federal funds and require no county match. The only string attached is that we reinvest them into permanency for children. We do that. And I'll give you an example. We had a large sibling group of 5 children who were siblings, and they were adopted. And the family did not have a washer and a dryer. Now, if you can imagine adding 5 children to your household when you didn't have any. So these funds were used to help enhance that home for the adoption, and we bought a washer and a dryer for the family. So they're very concrete things that we do for families and for children. We pay for counseling, we pay for tutoring, those kinds of things that lead to permanence for these children and good outcomes. So this is our performance-based award from the federal government, $63,000.
I'll make a motion we do that.
Second.
On first say aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. I vote yes occasionally. It's rare.
Just hold on to that one now.
Okay.
It's on film.
Okay, county manager reports.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And kind of keeping up with kind of the history of the county is our first meeting in July is usually being canceled. We're coming off a furlough day and a holiday, and then it would be a commissioner's meeting. So the history has been that we've canceled the first meeting in July, if that is okay with this board.
Oh, shucks.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Got a motion.
Yes, there's not a lot coming up.
I have a motion. I need a second. A second, all in favor say aye. Okay.
The second request that we have is we have been working locally with the chamber and the city of Mebane on an economic incentive opportunity for the county. The company is not ready to make any announcement at this point, but there's a certain time frame they're trying to work under. With the board's approval, we would need to call for a special call meeting for June 29th. And at that point, the only thing on the agenda would be to set the public hearing for July 12th. And at that point on the 29th, we will be able to announce the company that is requesting the incentives.
Do you have a time on that?
It's whatever is good for this board.
I'm okay. Mornings, whatever.
Mornings, evening. It should be a 5 to 10 minute meeting. But we would announce the company.
How about a 9 o'clock? Is that okay?
I'll make the motion 9 o'clock.
Okay.
Okay, at 9 a.m. on June the 29th. Have we got any meetings on that night then? Do we have any ribbon cuts?
I don't know.
I don't think we do.
Wednesday, if I'm not mistaken. Tuesday, I'm sorry.
Now I'm thinking about it. I got a class I got to teach.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
What time? What?
Okay, no, I don't. Well, you know, I got to be there. Let me check my calendar. I'm sorry. I should have done this by now. I think that class is July. It's the first week or so in July. I'm sorry. I'm doing one now. Yeah, I got a class that week.
All we got to do is set the 29th of June.
We set the June 29th at 9, and then you would know about the July 12th?
Yeah, right. 9. Yeah, that'll work.
Is the morning okay?
Yeah, morning's okay for the 29th, and then he'll know.
We'll set the date and time at that meeting.
That'll right.
Okay.
We'll work with that.
June 29th.
We're good. June 29th at 9 o'clock. Yeah. Okay. Do we need to vote on that one?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. Okay, the next is the consent agenda. I'd like to pull. I got two I want to pull.
Okay, I'd like to pull C.
That's what I want to pull.
And F.
Same thing. I had a request. You must have the same request.
Well, you take C and I'll be well.
Okay.
I don't know if we both have
them. Okay, C is the, what we're pulling is a resolution opposing the current state laws allowing forced annexation. And that one is, whereas the North Carolina General Statutes allow municipalities to annex properties meeting statutory standards without involvement of the affected property owners nor the affected county through a process commonly referred to as forced annexation. And whereas when forced annexation occurs, municipalities are often required to extend public utilities like sewer systems, which allows higher population densities within these annexation areas. And whereas even after annexation occurs, the county is still required by state laws to provide specific services to residents within the annexation areas, including school facilities, emergency medical services, public health services, and various social-related services. And whereas, although the county is still required to provide these services, which constitute a substantial amount of the county's operating and capital budgets, the county loses a significant amount of revenue due to the shifting of sales tax dollars tied to the area's annex. And whereas residents under consideration for forced annexation are not allowed to vote on this issue, nor do they have representation on the governing body making the final decision. And whereas residents have limited recourse if the municipality fails
to deliver all urban services within a defined reasonable timeframe. And whereas residents affected by forced annexation have no appeal process short of pursuing legal action through the court system. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners expresses strong opposition to the current state laws allowing forced annexation. Be it further resolved that the Alamance County Board of Commissioners respectfully requests the North Carolina General Assembly to repeal the forced annexation laws contained in Article 4A of Chapter 160A of the North Carolina General Statutes. All right, next. Okay.
So I think that's going through Congress now. Yeah, I think that's
not Congress, the House.
Senate.
Yeah,
well, Senate. One half, I'm not sure which right. one it is. Okay, you ready for 14F?
Yeah.
Okay, you put that one back in.
Yeah, I'm putting
okay.
this one back in.
This is a proclamation, Vulnerable Adult and Elder Abuse Awareness Month. Whereas the state of North Carolina and Alamance County joined the world in recognizing World Elder Abuse Awareness Day, which was on June 15th. And whereas national and international research shows that abuse, neglect, exploitation of vulnerable and older adults are grossly underreported. And whereas North Carolina's vulnerable and older adults of all socioeconomic, racial, and ethnic backgrounds may be targets of abuse, neglect, or exploitation, which occurs in families, long-term care facilities, and communities. And whereas the recognizing the need for a comprehensive system of protection, North Carolina enacted the nation's first elder abuse law in 1973 and has been providing protective services to adults age 18 to 59 throughout its 100 county departments of social services since 1975. And whereas there is a rapidly growing population of older adults in North Carolina with evolving needs. And whereas in 2009, more than 17,000 reports of abuse, neglect, exploitation of vulnerable and older adults were made to North Carolina's 100 county departments of social services office. And whereas the Division of Aging and Adult Services partners with county departments of social services to offer statewide adult protective services programs with area agencies on aging to increase awareness about elder abuse through its long-term care ombudsman program with State Attorney General's office to assist victims of telemarketing and scams. And whereas protecting North Carolina's vulnerable and older adults in a societal responsibility, and it is imperative that communities work together to help reduce and prevent abuse, neglect, and exploitation. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners that we support the state of North Carolina in its proclamation of May 10th, June 18th, 2010 as Vulnerable Adult and Elder Abuse Awareness Month in North Carolina, and hereby support our local Alamance County Department of Social Services in its effort to improve the safety and well-being of vulnerable and older adults and secure their rights to live free of abuse, neglect, and exploitation this 21st day of June 2010.
And we put that one back in.
Back in.
Okay, anybody else got anything to pull on the consent agenda?
Nope.
If not, do I hear a motion we accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
Have a motion
second.
To accept and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Commissioners, comments?
Hang on.
Yeah.
We furloughed all county employees, but I'm not so sure that the Board of County Commissioners were involved in that. And as leaders in this county, and I think we should lead by example, I'd like to make a motion that we also be furloughed, but I would volunteer that 2% myself. And I'm not sure I can speak for anyone else here, but I would take the 2% and be furloughed.
No, I don't have a problem with that. As a matter of fact, you and I talked about that, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, 2% of my salary ain't a whole lot, so.
2% of not much is not much.
I'll make that motion then.
I'll second it.
Okay, have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No opposed? Okay.
2% of a dollar ain't bad. Just kidding.
Okay.
I had one comment.
Okay, Eddie, I'm sorry.
Don't mind. Miriam's leaving us.
And yeah, she is.
Just wanted to thank her for her service here. I know it was short, but she did a great job. She helped Clyde out a lot, and I know he's going to miss her.
I wonder why you was crying in the hall a couple of days ago.
Yeah, we're going to miss that big smile. We're going to be thoroughly missed. You don't have to go. You can go on weekends to South Carolina. See, we've got it worked out.
I will be back to visit, I promise.
Okay.
Please do.
Okay. Mr. Burgess, if you'll come up and give us that information.
Yes, Madam Chair, members of the board. You asked about the statutory limits on using architects and engineers. Let me give you a couple of things we incur. One is that any projects that are $30,000 and above that we have to use have a general contractor's license.
Wait a minute. Slow down.
Okay. Any projects that are $30,000 and above, we have to have the contractor has to have a general contractor's license, according to General Statute 87-1. So that's one thing that we incur with projects. If it's over $30,000 and above, that we got to have a general contractor. The question's also been asked about why we couldn't use our own people to do this work. Part of it may be that we don't have the requisite skill levels. When we got very skilled maintenance employees, very skilled, but in some of the areas, they may not have the experience that we would need. But the statute does address that also in that we cannot, if the total project is $125,000, we cannot use our own labor force to do that work. That's under General Statute 143-135. If the labor portion of it is $50,000, then we cannot use our own labor forces. In other words, our maintenance department cannot do the work if the labor is going to be $50,000 or the overall project is going to be at least $125,000. We cannot use our own labor force. Now, getting into the aspect of using a registered architect or an engineer, and this is a General Statute 133-1.1A, again, General Statute 133-1.1A. You're required to use a registered architect or an engineer if the non-structural work is $300,000 and above. So if the repair work is non-structural in nature, if it's $300,000 and above, you have to use a registered architect or an engineer. If it is structural repair or new construction and it's $135,000 and above, you have to use a registered architect or an engineer. So again, if it's structural repair or new construction, if it's $135,000 and above, you have to use a registered architect or an engineer. If it is repair work affecting life safety systems, if it's $100,000 and above, you have to use a registered architect and engineer. So again, repair work affecting the life safety systems, then you have to, and it's $100,000 and above, you have to use a registered architect and engineer. Now, going back to the roofing projects that you'd asked about, let me give you the dollar amounts on those. The HSC, which was the old same-day surgery wing, county office building here, and next to us the civil courts building, the construction cost on that project was $395,996. Now that doesn't include contingency, the design fees, not just the basic construction contract amount was $395,996. HSC, the remainder of HSC, which is about, it's over 35,000 square feet of roofing, that project is $566,500. So you can see the dollar amounts on those. And then the last one is the Register of Deeds, Elderly Services, and Central Permitting. That one's $141,250. So not only do you have the aspect of the statute requiring you to have a registered architect or an engineer, because of the difficulty of some of the roofing designs that we have to have the engineers plus the bidding process for them to assist with getting the specifications together for the roofing projects for the bid process. That's where they also come in to assist the county.
May I ask, do you have that written down, printed out, or what?
This happens to be copyrighted by the UNC Chapel Hill School of Government. Says do not duplicate, but I'll see if I can find
it's
you something.
It's general statute. Print out through an email to us.
There, and I can, and I can actually, but I can get you what you need. Be glad to get that out to the board.
Please.
I was thinking about copying this, but it said do not duplicate.
Do not copy. Okay.
Okay. Everybody, me and talk to him after. Okay, next is announcements. Any announcements?
I'd like to ask a question. Ms. Vaughn, you have stirred some... the people affected in the furlough are just hourly employees. Is that correct?
No, sir. Salary is included.
Everybody's
all right, out. Straight salary people?
I'm included.
Okay. All right. I was going to get you if you
want. It hurts me more than it hurts anybody else.
All right. How is that figured on straight salary, though? You know, if you're paid X amount of dollars and you don't punch a clock, how is that?
We base it on hours that you know, it's a day's pay. And we'll subtract that out from your monthly check.
So everybody, including Mr. Burgess here.
Yes, Mr. Burgess is included.
Including Mr. Epps
and our county attorney.
He is part time.
Is our county attorney?
He doesn't work full time. He will not be working that day. It includes our county attorney. Every employee is included.
So what did I do? Anything else?
No, if I was going to get up too.
He was too.
Why did he was?
I want to make sure he was.
All right. I promise that never was any discussion about not.
Okay. Nobody's left untouched.
The quarter percent sales tax resolution.
You guys approved it last time, but there was an error in it.
Oh, we need to redo it.
Last time.
Oh, it's in here. Okay.
Okay.
Well, fine. Okay, if nothing else, we are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.